क्योंकि वो नोटिस आया था ना उस हिसाब से। हाँ गुड मॉर्निंग, यू हियर मी? एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस
सो
सर।
सो विदाउट ऑर्डर, या गुड मॉर्निंग। सो विदाउट मच वेस्टेज ऑफ टाइम, वी मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक। सो वी आर मूविंग फ्रॉम प्रॉक्सिमल टू डिस्टल। सो वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस प्रोबेबली द मोस्ट कॉमन फ्रैक्चर दैट यू विल कम अक्रॉस इन योर टेन्योर एज अ डॉक्टर, और मे बी इफ सम ऑफ यू गो ऑन टू बी एन ऑर्थोपेडिक सर्जन। सो दिस इज वन फ्रैक्चर दैट will be almost a bread and butter for you. So this is not just important from the clinical point of view, but also from the examination point of view. Each and everything about the distal radius fracture, mainly the colis fracture, is very important for you, because late, the other topics that have been covered for you, those are a little, I would say, a little difficult as compared to what you should be knowing at your level. But not knowing in detail about colis fracture and mostly distal radius fractures, that's not excusable for the exam. So I'll be talking in brief about some of the important fractures that we talk about, that we know in the distal end of the radius, starting with a little bit about the anatomy, like we brushed up in the last time, in the last class. We talked about the radius and lana and the interosseous membrane and those things. Now we talk about the radio ulnar joint. The wrist joint basically is a radiocarpal joint constituted by the lower end of the radius, the ulna, as well as the carpal bones. And like we mentioned in the last time, when we talked about Monteggia fracture, there was disruption of the proximal radio ulnar joint here and the Gagliese fracture. So we again brush up about the distal radio ulnar joint, that is the DRUJ. This joint complex, and for your anatomy, these are the 8 carpal bones that we normally have, that we should know by heart. Most importantly, the relation of the radius with the scaphoid. Then you have got the, I think you know the mnemonic, no? Teacher to teachers, Cunningham students like to play. Is it known to you? I know there might be some other mnemonics for you. I am not getting any answer. Yes, are you aware of the name?
Yes, sir.
So, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
This is it. Teachers Cunningham, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Cunningham, students.
Yes,
so I don't think I need to brush up those things, but just remember that the close association of the scaphoid with the distal end radius. So next class, if we finish today's topic on time. So we'll be talking a little bit about the scaphoid fracture. So this is these are few important relationships that you need to know. Most important is that the radial styloid process, it is longer than the ulnar styloid process by so much, so as normally this length X is around about 11 to 12 millimeter, range can be from 8 to 18 millimeter. So if you palpate your own wrist joints, you'll find that the radial styloid is longer than the ulnar styloid, so radius is longer. And if you take a line which is drawn perpendicular to the radial shaft and another line at 90 degree, and if you join the tip of the articular surfaces of the radius, you'll find that this line, which is also known as a radial angulation, is normally this angle that is subtended here is around about 22 to 23. Just remember it to be in the range of 20 degree. So this is radial angulation. And this is volar angulation of the radius. So if you take an X-ray and look at the lateral view, you will find that the radius is volarly tilted, that is palmarly tilted anteriorly. And the angle that is subtended by the lines, if we draw here a line along the long axis of the radius, another line 90 degree to that, and another, the final line, which is touching the anterior and the posterior articular surface of the radius. If you draw this line, you'll find that this angle on the lateral view, which is the volar angulation, is around about 11 to 12 degrees. Remember, just if you don't remember the angle, it's okay, fine. But just remember that the radius is volarly angulated. It is not dorsally tilted. So in the lateral view, the volar angulation is around about 10 degrees. And in the AP view, the radial angulation is around about 20 degrees. You can remember that very simple. Don't go into the finer details. You just remember 20 degrees on the AP view and 10 degrees on the lateral view. The length of the radius being a little longer than the radius by around about 10 to 12 millimeter. Now, we move on to the most common fracture. Yeah, Vishal, you wanted to say something? There was a slight internet disruption. Are you getting me? Are you hearing me properly?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, the Colles fracture, which was first described by way back in 1814 by Abraham Colles. It's basically a fracture at the corticocancellous junction of the distal radius, 2 centimeters proximal to the distal articular surface of the radius with typical displacements. See, this diaphyseal area of the bone is a cortical part, and the metaphyseal part is a cancellous area. So the junction between the cortical and the cancellous area, an extra-articular fracture, a fracture not involving the joint, is basically known as a Colles fracture. It will be eponymous with certain displacements that I'll be talking about. But what is important for you to know is that Colles fracture is an extra-articular fracture, does not involve the joint, and it occurs in the cortico-cancellous junction, normally around 2 centimeters proximal to the distal articular surface of the radius. It is commonly seen in elderly female patients, most commonly in postmenopausal females. Mechanism of injury is fallen down, stretched hand with the wrist in extension. You can see here, wrist is extended. Okay. This is important because when we compare about another fracture, which is the reverse of Colles, the mechanism of injury will be different. So remember that the wrist is in extension. The displacements in Colles fracture is very important pathoanatomy. Basically, there are 6 of them. There is a dorsal shift and a dorsal tilt, along with a lateral shift and a lateral tilt. Now see what happens here. Whenever there is any fracture, we told you in the last class that we talk about the displacement in relation to the distal or the proximal fragment. Remember that? Anyone?
Yes, sir.
Which fragment proximal. Is it normally taken into account? Proximal or distal?
Proximal.
Proximal. Mr. Bipin. He's talked so much about supraorbital fractures. We talk so much about displacements in the both bone fora. Yes, and now you are telling me that you are talking about displacements in relation to the proximal fragment. You forgot so soon. We spent maybe around 10 to 15 minutes talking about displacements always to be mentioned in relation to the distal fragment. Now you are saying that you are talking about the proximal fragment. You've forgotten everything about you. Were you there in the last class, Bipin? I could not see your surname.
Yes, sir.
Bipin Mahato. So, what is the fragment which you take into account when you talk about displacement? Distal or proximal?
Distal, sir.
So, why did you say proximal? Chalo. I hope there is nothing to be sorry about it. It's basically not paying attention to the previous classes, or maybe you were not present, I don't know. But if you make this exam this mistake in the exam, then things will be tight for you. Okay. So see, this is the lateral view and this is the AP view. You can see that the distal fragment has gone dorsally. So this is called a dorsal tilt. It may be angulated also. If there is angulation along with the tilt, it's called a dorsal tilt or a dorsal shift. On the AP view, you find that the distal fragment has gone laterally. So if the translation is accompanied by some degree of rotational movement, it will be known as angulation. So basically, the four displacements are very simple. It will be dorsally placed, it may be tilted also, it may be laterally placed, it may be laterally tilted also. So dorsal and lateral shift, dorsal and lateral tilt are okay, fine. And sometimes you find that the fracture fragments, instead of getting dorsally or laterally displaced, they impact against each other. They get crushed into each other. And in those patients, if you see clinically or also on the X-ray, you will find that the radial styloid, which was felt maybe 1.5 centimeter distal to the tip of the ulnar styloid, will be almost at the same level, or that distance will be reduced. Because the radius has impacted into each other, the radial styloid process will no longer be felt more distally as compared to the ulnar styloid, because it will be impacted. And lastly, the distal fragment may go into supination. So these are the six displacements which will be invariably asked in the exam. You should justify each and every one of them. There may be a dorsal shift along with a lateral shift. There might be a dorsal tilt along with a lateral tilt. Impaction, how do you find it? By comparing the styloid tip processes and supination. Now, there may be other associated injuries, because if the fall is of a high velocity injury, and you might find associated injury of the ulnar styloid fragment, as you can see in this fracture. This small fleck of bone has been avulsed from the ulnar styloid. So this is the ulnar styloid fracture. There might be rupture of the ulnar collateral ligament, which is here. There might be rupture of the, this is TFCC, is a triangular fibrocartilage complex. This is a fan-shaped triangular sheet of tissue which stabilizes the distal radial ulnar joint by attachment to the ulnar styloid in the radius, distal end of radius. This is basically here. This TFCC is a fan-shaped cartilaginous structure which is attached to the distal end of the radius and the ulna. And sometimes there might be rupture of the interosseous radial ulnar ligament, leading to a distal radial ulnar joint subluxation. So these are associated injuries which may be there in case of a colis fracture. So in one thing I would like to say, that it is not necessary that you will find all the six displacements in one particular case. You will find a combination of one or two, maybe three or four, but it is not mandatory that you will find all the displacements in one fracture. It is not possible, in fact. Okay. So these are the permutation and combination of all the displacements that you might get. But don't commit in the exam, but that you will see all the six of them. In some cases, you might only see an impaction. In some cases, you might see only a tilt, dorsal tilt. In some cases, you might feel got to get a shift also. So it depends on the from fracture to fracture. But what is important is to know the other associated injuries. Ulnar styloid may be avulsed. Ulnar collateral ligament may be injured. Triangular fibrocartilage complex might be there, and there might be disruption of the distal radial ulnar joint. Now, how does the patient clinically present to you? This is classical, you'll not miss it. This one is a Dinner fork deformity, almost simulating the Dinner forks that the fork, commonly used forks that we use. There will be the decreased range of motion. There might be tenderness, there will be swelling. And the radial styloid uprights to lie at the same level or a little higher than the ulnar styloid. So this indicates that there is a impaction. Investigations, the same, a plain AP and a lateral view. And you can see here, there's a break in the corticocancellous junction. Here, there is not much of a displacement. A slight lateral displacement, lateral shift might be there, you can consider with a slight degree of maybe dorsal tilt. So you can see two deformities. And if you see, if you draw a line between the tip of the radius and the tip of the ulna, you'll find that this distance has significantly reduced. This normal 10 millimeter or 12 millimeter distance has been almost bridged. So there's some amount of impaction also. So you can see impaction, lateral shift, and a dorsal tilt. Three deformities that we talked about just now can be seen on these two X-rays. Okay. Treatment for an undisplaced fracture, just a below elbow cast immobilization is enough without any manipulation, because the fracture is not displaced. Whereas if there is a typical displacement is there, you do a close reduction and a below elbow slab or a cast is to be applied for around 4 to 6 weeks. So for all displaced fractures, the principle remains the same. You apply traction and counter traction for disimpacting the fragments. Then you correct the dorsal tilt by See, when there is a dorsal tilt, you'll have to correct it by giving the opposite force. So you'll be giving a palmar flexion. The wrist will be going into palmar flexion. And for correction of the radial tilt, you will give ulnar deviation. You can see that for correction of the radial tilt, this wrist is displaced in the ulnar way. This is known as ulnar deviation. Whereas for the dorsal tilt, this has been corrected by giving a palmar flexion. So you can remember that 20 degrees of palmar flexion and 20 degrees of ulnar deviation is normally enough to maintain the fractured displaced fragments. Final position of police cast will be pronation, because the deformity which we talked about was supination of the distal fragment. So you have to put the wrist into pronation, some degree of palmar flexion, and this is ulnar deviation. But remember to take a check x-ray after the reduction to confirm whether the reduction has been achieved or not. And you have to repeat the x-rays serially at 7 or 14 or 21 days. Because what happens, the plaster being a rigid cylinder, because the swelling which has inside the plaster may have reduced, and the potential space which has been created between the plaster and the injured part of the patient may give rise to some potential space which may further redisplace the fractured fragment. So it is very important that you take at least another check x-ray at least 14 days after the application of the first plaster. And if you find that the fracture has reduced significantly, change the plaster and reapply another one. Now, this is very important, because if we do not counsel the patient what to do after the application of the plaster, most of these patients present to you with something known as a shoulder stiffness or finger stiffness and a lot of morbidities. So you ask the patient to keep the limb elevated. Shoulder, elbow, and finger movement should be emphasized. They should be encouraged and always asked to keep moving their shoulder, the elbow joint, as well as the fingers. Otherwise, they'll develop stiffness. The cast should be immediately removed if signs of compartment syndrome develop. So what are the signs of compartment syndrome? Compartment syndrome, the patient will cause of, they'll come to you with excessive pain, which is out of proportion to the injury that is suspected. They might have a pallor, or they might have paresthesia or altered sensation. They'll have pins and needles sensation. Some patients may have, in fact, paralysis of the limb. So these are things which we'll be talking about when we talk about compartment syndrome. But you should just know that the immediate signs which are very important for you to diagnose are that patients with imminent compartment syndrome will come to you with a swollen, painful, paresthetic limb. And the treatment is to immediately cut the plaster. In fact, in some patients, you can advise them even to cut the plaster at home and report to you. It is better to lose the reduction than losing the limb of the patient. This fracture normally heals by 6 weeks, following which physiotherapy has to be started. See, till now we have talked about the undisplaced fractures and displaced fractures without severe impaction or without the, I mean, see, if you go back to the slides, if you talk about the typical displacements, we do this. But in certain cases, because of the instability or the gross combination of the fractures, these fractures may not be amenable to only a cast with close reduction. They have to be further stabilized by some form of fixation. So in severely impacted or fragmented fractures, we may have to resort to the K-wiring, which means it's unclosed or open. We may have to resort to fixation by a locking plate, or you can apply an external fixator. The principle of the external fixator being the principle of ligamentotaxis. Ligamentotaxis means maintaining the fracture by maintaining the length and tension of the ligaments around the fracture. So see, this will not be asked in detail for you. Just remember that how do you treat a colis fracture? The answer should be, most cases we treat it by close reduction. If the fracture is undisplaced, we apply the plaster in situ. If the fracture is displaced, we do reduction. If it is still not reduced, then we may have to go for internal fixation. That can be in the form of either a key wire, like you see here. It can be in the form of plates and screws, or it may be in the form of an external fixator. Now, how's the outcome? A little words about the outcome of the patient. In most cases, most of the patients without, they heal with a slight degree of malunion, which is quite acceptable to the patients. And initially, you will find that most patients with a gross deformity which have not been treated properly in a medical setup or maybe by quacks, even they have a fairly good range of function of the affected wrist joint. So cosmetic disfigurement is not a very big issue because most of the patients do well. The patients who do fairly poorly with the conservative treatment are those who have got a radial length shortening by more than 3 millimeter, where the dorsal tilt is and the palmar tilt are more than 15 degree or 20 degree from the neutral. So this you may omit if you want to, but you can remember one thing, that most patients with a colis fracture, they tolerate a fair degree of malunion. We are lucky that this fracture unites rapidly. It does not produce non-union, but some degree of malunion is quite compatible with life. So that was a colis fracture. Just a minute. Now, Smith fracture. I told you to remember the mechanism of injury in a colis fracture. It was on the wrist in extension. Here you find that since it's the reverse of colis, the Smith fracture, the patient normally falls on an outstretched hand with the wrist in flexion. Okay, the wrist is flexed. And here, the displacement is just the opposite. The distal fragment will go ventrally or anteriorly, and there is a, instead of a dorsal shift, there will be a volar tilt. Okay, along with there might be a volar shift also. It is more unstable than the colis fracture, and the deformity here is just the reverse. In the colis fracture, we had a deformity which was like this, which was a dinner fork deformity. Here it is the reverse. It is known as a garden spade deformity. Plain X-ray, AP and lateral view will confirm your diagnosis. Now, since these fractures are unstable, more often than not, you have to go for a internal fixation. Here we talked about, in the last slide, we talked about fixation of the distal end of radius colis fracture by K-wires. We talked also about plates. So this is how a volarly applied plate will look to you. This is a plate and screws which has been applied to the distal end of radius. Now, Smith and colis fractures are extra-articular fractures of the distal end of the radius. Now we talk about another entity which is known as a Barton's fracture. Remember that this Barton's fracture is basically an intra-articular fracture. So if the Barton's fracture involves the fracture end of distal end of the radius along with volar shift of the carpus along with the distal end of the radius, that is known as a volar Barton's fracture, which is much more common. If it involves the dorsal chunk of the distal radius along with dorsally placed displacement of the carpal bones, it is known as a dorsal Barton fracture. So with these words, I'll just talk about a few lines about this. It's a high energy trauma. It's an intra-articular fracture, as I just mentioned. It can be either volarly or dorsally displaced. It's a highly unstable fracture and demands restoration of articular congruity, LML. So it, more often than not, these fractures will require an operative intervention. So usually the treatment is operative, either closed reduction or open reduction with K-wires or locking plates we have just seen. This can be imparted to these also, and an external fixator might also be applied. So here you see a picture of an external fixator being applied, two pins on the second metacarpal and two pins on the radial shaft, which have been supplemented by two K-wires. So this is basically a combination of different modalities of fixation. But what is important to remember is that colis fracture and Smith fracture are extra-articular fractures, colis being the most common. Volar Barton's fracture has been divided into volar Barton. A Barton's fracture has been divided into volar Barton and dorsal Barton, depending on whether this fragment, this is basically a dorsally displaced fracture of the dorsal fragment along with the carpal bones, or a volarly displaced fracture of the distal radius along with the carpal bones. So depending on the main fragment, it is either classified into a volar Barton or a dorsal Barton, a volar Barton being more common. Now see, even if you don't remember a word about volar Barton or dorsal Barton, nobody is going to say anything to you. But this particular slide is perhaps the most important slide for you in this lecture. What are the complications of the distal end of the radius or colis fracture or whatever, all distal end radius fractures, the complications are very, very important. Each and every one, every point of it is important for you. So like we have been discussing earlier, they can also be divided into early and late complications. Early complications being there can be injury to the nerve, median nerve compression because of excessive palmar flexion. If we extend the flexion of the immobilized wrist beyond 20 degrees, or if there is a extensive hematoma which is compressing upon the flexor retinaculum, the median nerve may be compressed. The patients may develop something known as CRPS or complex regional pain syndrome, also known as Sudex osteodystrophy. This itself is a short note where the patients will come with shiny, tense, painful, swollen fingers, and the patient normally they have got a gross restriction of movement. So this is itself another short note, Sudex osteodystrophy. They may have pain around the ulnar end or the ulnar corner because of disruption of the distal ilioulnar joint. These patients may have instability. They might have associated injuries of the other carpal bones, and these fractures may redisplace. So the early complications are nerve injury, which may be in the form of a median nerve injury. Don't say about radial nerve and ulnar nerve just to fill up the space, okay? You have to be specific for which nerve is involved and why. I told you median nerve may be injured because of excessive flexion of the wrist, because the nerve may be compressed, or it might be because of excessive swelling compressing the nerve inside the flexor retinaculum. Then Sudex osteodystrophy, this is a complication which occurs in certain patients where the patients are not following your protocol of physiotherapy properly. They do not do proper wrist and finger, wrist is immobilized. They do not do finger exercises. They do not do their physiotherapy, which was explained to them. They come to you with a typical finding of very tense, swollen, and shiny fingers, which will be totally having a very less degree of movement. And if you take an X-ray of that part, you will find that the whole area, the bones, they look very osteoporotic. If you compare it to the other parts of the body, you will find that whole affected area, the wrist along with the fingers will have a mottled appearance, and they will almost present like a ground glass appearance to you, very hazy. So read up Sudex osteodystrophy separately. These patients may have ulnar corner pain and instability. They might have associated injuries of the other carpal bones, and they may also have redisplacement. Now, late complications are in fact more important than early complications. Now, I told you just a while back that do not say about non-union in cancellous fracture area, in cancellous areas, okay? Like supracondylar fractures, they rarely present to you with a non-union. So also the colis fracture, both being extra-articular fractures. So malunion is very common, and this is either because of improper reduction or redisplacement. So it is important to check after the application of the plaster after 7 or 14 days. If you find that some degree of redisplacement is occurred, you change the cast and you can get away with this problem. Delayed union and non-union are rare, just as I told you, unless infected or severe bone loss with instability is there. So for you at your level, even if you do not complete cartoscopy. Okay. So delayed union or non-union, even if you don't say a word about it in the exam, nobody is going to ask you about anything. But don't say that complication of colis fracture, late complications, do not start with non-union, please. At least I'll be pissed off. It is malunion, which is most common. You can forget about this. There might be delayed rupture of tendons like the extensor pollicis longus or the flexor pollicis longus because of irritation of the tendons which glide over the wrist. In long-standing cases, sometimes you may find that these patients come to you with rupture of the tendons. There might be carpal instability, and ultimately these patients may have secondary osteoarthritis. See, in complications of colis fracture, what is most important for you is knowing about the malunion. Okay. Forget about delayed union or non-union. That is not important for you. You can remember a word or two about tendon rupture, mainly extensor pollicis longus and flexor pollicis longus, carpal instability, and secondary osteoarthritis. So with this, we finish off the distal end of the radius. Now, if you remember the lecture on lateral condyle of the humerus, we talked about type 1 and type 2, MILS 1 and 2, where we talked about epiphyseal injury type 2 and type 4. Remember a few words about that? So I told you that there is a classification on the distal end of the epiphyseal injuries by Salter and Harris. So this picture depicts the various types. This is just a single slide which you can go through, and to take you to the through the next few slides, as usual, I'll ask Dr. Sachin to wind up the topic. So I'm handing over the class mic to him.
Good morning, everyone. Now coming to sir. Coming to pediatric distal radius fracture, as you all know, in pediatric age group there will be epiphysis, physial plate, and then the metaphysis and diaphysis. In pediatric age group, in the distal radius, there will be physial injury, which is more common, and it is classified according to Salter and Harris classification. It has five types. For your level, it's enough. Actually, there are nine types recently. In type one, there will be separation of the physis between the metaphysis and the epiphysis. You can see the gap here. There will be separation of this physis. Usually, this will heal on its own on immobilization. There won't be any growth restriction. Coming to type two, there will be physial injury along with a fragment of the metaphysis involved in the fracture. And this fracture, this fragment of the metaphysis is known as Thurston-Holland fracture. This is the most commonest type we can see in pediatric age group with the physial fracture. Coming to type 3, there will be physial injury along with the fracture extending to the articular surface involving the epiphysis. And this is the common fracture which requires surgical stabilization because we need to restore the articular congruity. Otherwise, there will be secondary osteoarthritis, growth restriction in the future. Coming to type 4, there will be involvement of the all three parts, physis, epiphysis, and the metaphysis. Coming to type 5, this is the most deadliest type because we can't diagnose it in the X-ray. There will be impaction of the physis between the metaphysis and the epiphysis, and we cannot diagnose it on the X-ray. And it will be diagnosed in the later life when the kid becomes an adult. There will be restriction of the growth in type 5. Coming to next fractures, it will be classified as incomplete and complete fractures. In incomplete fractures, there are two types. First one is torus or buccal fracture. The second one is green stick fractures. Why there is incomplete fracture means in pediatric age group, the bone will be very soft when compared to the adult bones. In adult bones, it's like a pencil which breaks immediately with the sharp edges. But in children, bone will be very soft and it won't break just like in adults. The torus fracture, there will be just buckling of the cortex as seen here. There won't be any break in the cortex, just a buckling. You can see here and in here. And this does not require any manipulation. They just immobilize the limb with the slab or the cast and it will heal on its own. Coming to green stick fractures, in this fractures, there will be break only in one cortex. Here you can see only one cortex is broken and the other cortex is bent. The cortex is intact here, but the cortex is bent. And this fracture requires manipulation and above elbow or below elbow cast immobilization. Then there is metaphysial fractures, which is undisplaced and adult type displaced metaphysial fractures. In undisplaced metaphysial fractures, you can simply apply slab or cast. In displaced fractures, you need manipulation and cast immobilization. Treatment is usually conservative, which includes cast immobilization after closed manipulation. In case of complete fractures, there is a necessary to exaggerate the deformity just to disimpact the periosteum before attempting the reduction. Even there are complications in pediatric distal radius fractures, dividing into early and late. In early complications, there will be forearm swelling and compartment syndrome. In late complications, malunion is generally acceptable. Deformities up to 30 degrees is correctable. This is because the remodeling capacity in pediatric age group is greater than the adults, and this occurs over 1 to 2 years. Hence, even if there is some residual deformity after immobilization or reduction, this is acceptable. And the next one is radial ulnar discrepancy. Because of premature fusion of radial epiphyses, as I told, it will be seen in type 5 physial injury. Thank you. Abdul? Hello.